Episode 1 of MTB Frame Development. This season we're going to talk about all this current state of this 3D model. But at first I want to address one issue or concern that a lot of people raised in the comments. We are not decided to go away from aluminium tubing for good reasons. And carbon tubing makes a lot of sense for us. And we will elaborate on this a little bit later in the video. So don't worry. We got you. And yeah, we take you right now to the current status of the 3D model, where we are right now, and we give you all the details. So Luca, maybe you can walk us a little bit through the model and explain some details that we're already looking for. Like, let's maybe start here.
Yes, so first of all, here is our current CAG model. So we almost finalized all the lugs. And yeah, I will first show you the more interesting parts, I would say. So here is the bottom bracket X gearbox mount area.
Yeah, we want to try to make basically two frames in one because we found a lot of interesting concepts what you can do if you have a mountable bottom bracket.
Yes, so maybe some images will be easier for you to understand. So on this mount here, we could either mount the gearbox or we could also mount a normal bottom bracket, and it also allows us to play a bit later, for example in the bottom bracket eye or some
exactly.
Other stuff like that.
Gives us so much freedom. We can reposition the bottom bracket, move it back or forth or up or down. Of course, there's a lot of different parts we're going to use for that, but it also gives us access to the down tube. We can build in a storage. And what is super interesting, because we've learned so much with the actual benefits of the heavy gearbox, and we know a lot of downhill racers are looking for adding weights. So with this model, we can add like about, 2 kilograms of steel plates into the bottom bracket zone to make that bike feel as planted as an e-bike.
Yes, totally. And the goal is that you could play with it. You can adjust your own weight to have the weights which fit for your riding.
Exactly, to build and stack up weights as you desire, as it suits your need. But yeah, we wanted to talk a little bit about the part that isn't maybe completely finalized yet, is the shock mount. We have a lot of ideas. We want to build in a flip chip system, and we're not completely fixated on if we want to alter progression or button bracket drop by using the flip chip. And the core idea is this is going to be in a VHP 18 setting, and then we use shock extenders instead of different shock mounts, which reduces a little bit the different parts that we're going to need to alter the suspension. And also the MX and 29R rear wheel can be adjusted with that. So this is still a little bit in the concept stage, but what is pretty much 95% dialed in are the lugs. And for the lugs, can you maybe zoom out and
yeah,
we can
sure.
See all of the lugs. So we finalized the lugs for the size large for the moment. We got a quotation, we decided for a supplier, which is, in a 1.5 hours drive radius from us. It's going to be Spantec. Pretty excited to work with them because it's so close, we can visit them. And they are right now in the loop with us, with the emails. This is what I just received, so it's really just right now in time. Some final questions about the manufacturing, what they can optimize. And while we are doing that, while we are in that loop, we prepared a package for our actual Australian distributor, Alex Wallace. And he's a really good engineer. He's really experienced with FEM. This is one of the weaknesses. We don't have super much experience. And with the bonding surfaces, you really need in-depth experience. So this is going to be done external. Thanks, Alex, for the support. Probably we can share your results in 2 weeks, so it's gonna be very interesting. Let's look into what's coming next. So we talked about the lugs, the general design ideas behind it. Maybe you can give some ideas about the cable routing, Luca.
Yeah, sure. So our idea maybe for our first video, we are not that clear about it, but our main choice is to make cable routing either external or internal. So for people who want to have a better look, the internal cable routing would be like the
standard version.
Yeah, totally.
And then we want to add a little bit, maybe not as sexy as, but still well thought out external optional a bundle that you can at least mount the rear brake external, like Dario just did in the pink bike review for their brake test.
Yes.
Something maybe a little bit more sought out, but roughly in that direction. So that's going to be detailed in that zone exactly. And we still go in from the head tube, but we want to have it a little bit more sealed, more weatherproof than the previous version.
Yes, and also avoid the rattling.
Yeah, exactly. We want to fixate it with
the sharp edges also.
Sharp edges, avoid sharp edges. We learned from that mistakes in the past. We always took a lot of attention in the workshop to deburr them, but still it's not perfect. So we want to use plastic inserts here to protect all the cables perfectly. We keep the V7 rear triangle alive because we want to give current riders the option to upgrade. We always like to offer uptrade programs. So keeping that compatible keeps the cost low, of course. It's also very critical for us. We want to be selling those at a competitive price. And we don't want to like ask $4,000 for a frame or something like that. Crazy. So the scaled head tubes are pretty were pretty big concern for a few riders. We don't want to get crazy long because we still want to be able to accommodate dual crown forks. It's a criteria that a lot of people enjoy, that they can have this with 120 millimeters or 200 millimeters. And it's a crazy cool feature. And one other feature is really nice to look at. It's we use that like a dice, and this is going to count the frame sizes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And here we add a M10 thread, and that's going to be for the Panda Melon, hope I said that correctly, steering damper. As mentioned already, we are running small design for manufacturing optimizations and FEM optimizations before we really go into production. We estimate that we have the first CNC parts and the first carbon tubes, which we are going to do with Compotec. We're going to have a meeting with them in 1 hour to discuss the final details, and we also plan to visit them as well. So it's going to be a lot of factory tours for us, super exciting. Maybe you can explain a little bit why we did the lug split in the button bracket area. Probably yes. Nobody realized it yet, but these are two lugs instead of a single lug.
Yeah. Our first idea was to make it easier to manufacture.
So maybe we can show this first prototype we did. This was one piece. And obviously, as you can imagine, this is going to cost a hell lot of money. And we have a very clear vision about how much the product should cost in the end. So we really designed to cut the cost.
And also another advantage is that the C2 blocks will be always the same, whatever the size we have. So we could
reduce variance.
Yes. Yeah.
So actually the reasoning behind is that this part could always be the same anyways, but this part always leaves in a different angle for every size. And either you make really ugly head tubes, which we decided to make a dedicated head tube for each frame anyways, because we wanted to have really precise scaling throughout the sizes, that there is a defined growth step according to the reach.
Yeah.
And the other big advantage is that you can simply stack it together when the bonding process is being performed.
Yes.
So it solves a few problems for the manufacturing. Talking about costs, actually, we do have a probably different approach than most, at least small to middle scale frame builders, we basically define a target price that we want to be able to sell the product in the beginning, and then we develop the product in a way that we can reach that target price. We set a target price for around 3,000 euro. We don't want to have a bike for 4,000 euro just because it's locked. We don't want to make anything more expensive. Based on current quotations, we are able to reach that price target pretty good. And maybe in the future, we can even offer the aluminium version and even go back to the current price tag of 2,800 euro. Talking about the aluminium tubes, yeah, that was a lot of discussion under our first post. Our absolute core riders, core customers, were a little bit panicking that we changed direction, which we don't. I wrote down some good points why carbon tubes make sense right now. Carbon tubes are actually cheaper for us in the current state of the development, because for aluminium tubes we would have to open a mold to draw the tubes, because we don't want to just use the current tubes. They would be way too heavy, and the whole frame would be way too heavy if we would use the current tubing. Other advantages of carbon is, of course, like obviously the reverse carbon tubes are much lighter, they can be stiffer, the compliance can be controlled throughout the areas. We can add the compliance in the pedaling direction, here we can add the compliance in the fork impact direction, and we can really optimize it, especially with the process that Compotec is performing. It's the winding of the tubes, right? And it is much faster for prototyping. If we wanted to have a custom tube from Taiwan, it would probably be about 2 to 3 months, so we wouldn't be able to meet any timeline that we desire. Bringing back aluminium tubes in the later stage is definitely something we are totally open for, and we don't abandon aluminium tubes. We are just very open for carbon tubes, and always a new engineering project is always something where we can also, or we like to gain new experience. So we like to touch first experience points with carbon tubes as well. So now obviously you wonder what's happening next. We are gonna loop back to the past and talk about the development from version 1 to version 6, version 7 and the G2. And give you all the insights what actually was all the groundwork that already went into the project. So it's going to be a little bit history tour next week, and in 2 weeks hopefully we have the subject talking about the FEM results, and then we're going to visit, as I mentioned already, we're going to visit the CNC factory Spantec, and we visit the guys in Czech from Compotec and have very interesting videos about that, of course. And then probably in January, if everything goes to plan, we're going to bond the first frame together and be excited how then testing goes. So stay in the loop, sign up for the video channel if you didn't already, and we are super, super hyped, right?
Yeah.
It's really great energy in the house right now.